an associate professor and he is the head of department of electronics and communication engineering, university institute of engineering and technology, Kurukshetra University, Kurukshetra. He did his PhD from National Institute of Technology, Kurukshetra, in the department of electronics and communication engineering. He did his post graduation from Institute of Advanced Studies in Education University and did his BTech in Electronics and Instrumentation from MMEC, Maulana Kurukshetra University, Kurukshetra. He has more than 18 years of experience teaching graduate and postgraduate students. More than 31 students have completed their MTech dissertation under his guidance. His areas of interest are software-defined radios, cognitive radios, soft computing, wireless communications, wireless sensor networks, fuzzy system design, and advanced microprocessors. He has published more than 5 book chapters in different international books, has authored more than 10 books with Pearson, Ville, to name a few, and has more than 30 publications to his credit in the reputed national and international journals and more than 20 papers in international and national conferences also. He has also has 2 patents published to his credit. He has been chairman of special sessions in international and national conferences and has delivered a keynote address at various international conferences. He has also acted as organizing secretary for international conferences. He is having additional charge of training and placement officer, UIET Kurukshetra University, Kurukshetra, and heading the training and placement cell for more than 10 years now. He is the single point of contact and head of local chapters of Swayam Neptal, local chapter of UIET. He is the single point of contact for Infosys Campus Connected Program for UIET Kurukshetra. He is also the reviewer for many reputed journals such as International Journal of Communication System, Ville, to name a few. He has awarded as the Career Guru of the Month by Aspiring Minds. Welcome, sir. It's our privilege to have you here again. And the session is all yours now. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you, Manjula, ma'am, for introducing me to the participants. And I am very grateful and thankful to the ILM College and you for having me over for the session.
It's our honor also, sir.
Right. Thank you very much, ma'am. So I hope last time, the last lecture that I took, I was able to express some views or give some basic idea about how we will be going ahead in the fields of machine learning through LabVIEW. So today I'll be touching broadly the concept of fuzzy logic using the LabVIEW part, and then we'll be designing a practical greenhouse system. So I still hope that all the participants had started looking into the National Instrument Software, and if they are doing it, then we can do it parallelly also. I don't have any problem in that. I would like this session to again to be interactive so that you may allow participants so that we can have a discussion.
Yes, sir. Sure. We have unmuted them. They can unmute themselves.
Ma'am, what I'll do is I'll just share my screen with you.
Yes, sir.
I hope that you're able to see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Great.
I think there is one hand raised.
Yes, sir. Tangamma, KC. Any queries? Yeah, anything do you like to ask, sir? So, yes, ma'am. If any queries, if any issues, you can speak out, or else you can message it out. I think by mistake, hand has raised. Yes. Sir, you can continue, sir.
Right, ma'am. Thank you very much. So I hope that you are able to see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Great. So today what we'll be talking about is we'll be talking about introducing the fuzzy logic toolbox and implementation of the fuzzy system designer using the LabVIEW part. In the last lecture, what we did was we were talking about the LabVIEW, how to use it effectively for machine learning and other aspects. So I had shown you few working examples, right? How to utilize it. So what we'll do today is we'll talk about the similar pattern, and but we'll be specifically talking about the AI technique, that is the fuzzy logic. I hope everybody has heard this name, because this is one of the most common names that we encounter these days. Most of the household equipments are using this technique called as the fuzzy logic, and maybe in fewer times you will see your vehicles, you will see your structure. In fact, vehicles, again, we have the same thing. And there are so many things that we can analyze through this. So what we'll be doing is we'll be today analyzing and utilizing the features of the fuzzy system, right? So before I start, definitely this quote is required, because we are referring to fuzzy systems and we are referring to mathematical functions in all the modeling structures that we want to do, or the machine learning that we want to achieve. So Albert Einstein gave a very interesting fact and quote, and this is how it goes by. So what he said is very, very interesting and very important for our modeling. So he said that so far as the laws of mathematics refer to reality, they are not certain. Very interesting. They're not certain, right? And so far as they are certain, they do not refer to reality, right? So our systems also behave according to this statement itself. So Einstein in 1921 actually issued this particular quote, and I still assume and hope that you people are facing the similar kind of a problem while you work with the working systems, or you work with the working environment, designing models, etc. So whenever we are talking about anything which is real, it is basically not holding true, right? So the laws of mathematics and reality, definitely we have to have the mathematics part in between, and we have to have a balance in both the things. So that is what we are trying to achieve, right? Another important quote was given by Zadeh, and he actually referred to the complexity of the system, right? And he is the father of the fuzzy logic, as is normally referred to as, and a very big name in the fuzzy logic system. So what he said is also very, very important for us. What he said is, as complexity rises, precise statements lose meaning, and meaningful statements lose precision, right? So complexity is what we want to avoid in any systems, right? And the complexity of the systems, whenever it rises, the precise statements, they start losing their meaning, and the meaningful statements start losing precision if we are compensating for the other part, right? So again, the part is that we want to, we should actually do what? We should try and have a balance in the two things, and this is what we would actually like to achieve, right? And let's hope that we would be able to resolve a better system using the fuzzy logic structure. So today what we'll be talking about is, we'll be talking about a fuzzy logic based system. I'll be trying to introduce the things to you, right? So fuzzy logic based system is basically a knowledge driven or knowledge based structure. It is knowledge driven, where rule based and data based both are taken into consideration, right? So the inputs are derived, the inputs are given for fuzzification module, then the inference engine performs its necessary action, and the defuzzification produces a crisp output in the end, right? So this is a basic block diagram of a fuzzy logic system designer, right? So what we want is, we want that our system should be complex also, but rather than complex, we want to design an easy system, right? And the complexity should be resolved inside, right? So fuzzy logic provides a very, very interesting and easy solution for designing highly complex, highly non-linear systems. And this is the beauty about this particular AI language, that we will be able to design very easily whatever systems you are thinking about, right? So what we have is, this is a detailed model here. We have a fuzzifier here, we have an inference engine, and we have a defuzzifier, right? The output, basically the crisp output that you get out of this, is then taken back through different control systems and given to the fuzzifier again. Now, how the fuzzifier is getting input, now this is the knowledge base that I just referred to, knowledge base, right? So what we are doing is, we are keeping in view all the experts. I should write the word experts over here, right? The experts who are in designing a particular system, all that knowledge is kept in this particular block called as a knowledge base. The inputs are taken and then the fuzzification starts, right? So this is very interesting. We'll see how this happens. So fuzzification is what? Is it? It is a process of mapping inputs or mapping input values into crisp sets, right? To values into fuzzy sets, right? So in the end, again, what we'll get is, we'll get a crisp output in the end, right? But right now, fuzzification module is doing what? It is mapping the input values into crisp sets and the values in the fuzzy sets, right? Knowledge base, again, I have told you, it comprises of a rule base and a database, right? So knowledge can be taken from different expert systems or different experts who are working in that particular field. The knowledge can be driven, taken from them. They can let you understand different things, and they can you can even take the linguistic values also. As far as fuzzy logic is concerned, all the linguistic functions can be taken into consideration, and fuzzy data manipulation can be performed. Right? How we'll do it? I'll practically show you how we'll definitely design this. Right? So rule based or characteristics are the two things that are given by the domain expert. So we combine both of them to formulate a term called as knowledge base. This knowledge base helps us actually build the theoretical aspects and the outline of the system that we want to design, and then we can move ahead. The next part is, the next block was inference engine, and this particular inference engine works just like a human brain. So I hope you can relate it very well, how inference engine would work. So this is basically decision making structure for the fuzzy system, and based on the input from the fuzzifier and the set of control rules, the necessary control actions are thus decided by this fuzzy logic structure, right? So we are aggregating some inputs and then manipulating them. And lastly, what we do is, we defuzzify the entire structure, right? So defuzzification basically is converting the range of the values of output variables into the corresponding universe of discourse, right? So defuzzification is transforming any input received to crisp output. This is what I gave you, right? So crisp output is the one that we'll definitely have after the defuzzification module, and then we can utilize that output to provide the feedback to the system also, right? So how this defuzzification technique is done? There are five methods available: center of gravity or center of area, center of sums, height of defuzzification, center of largest area, min max approach. So if you see, mathematics is still there, right? So mathematics is still there, but we are talking about some linguistic functions to be implemented, right? Linguistic functions to be implemented and modeling to be done for complex systems in an easier way, right? So let's see how it happens, right? So the functional view of this particular system is basically how it looks like. We have fuzzy inputs, we apply the fuzzy operator to that, then apply the implication method, aggregate all the outputs, and lastly defuzzify, right? So when we defuzzify, what we get is, we get the crisp output out of this, right? So again, always remember this, crisp set and crisp output. So this is the internal functioning, how it looks like, right? So what we have is, you will have some inputs over here, we'll fuzzify them with some functions, say z, triangular, sigma, whatever you want to do, right? So this is the fuzzification part. Then composition happens, where min or max operator is taken, then Implication means we are multiplying the two things. Aggregation means we are taking the max out of it. And then lastly, defuzzification. I told you there are five methods for defuzzification, and then we have the crisp output. So this is the basic block diagram of the fuzzy logic structure, right? So advantages of fuzzy logic, very interesting. Why we are talking about this? The fuzzy logic structure deals or comes out with the best output in ill-defined systems, where we have imprecise knowledge, where we have incomplete information, where the concepts are ambiguous in nature, right? Or we have highly complex and non-linear systems available. So if you actually see, right, what we have is, or what we have seen here is that all the problems that we normally encounter in any systems can be easily removed by with the help of a fuzzy logic control, right? So what it does is it circumvents the need for what? It circumvents the need for rigorous mathematical treatment, right? So what, how will we do it? So it is very easy. Normally we talk in a particular fashion, right? So we are referring to some linguistic expressions in this case. Say I refer to a temperature for you. So what I do is I say today the temperature is 30 degrees. So some would call it moderate, some will call it hot, some might call it that it is okay for me. Right, so we are talking in terms. Now, how system should take it? Should it take it as hot? Should it take it as moderate? Should it take it as a cold temperature? Right, so there can be any condition. So this is where ambiguous conditions are there, right? So ambiguity is arised, and fuzzy logic deals it in the very, very interesting fashion. So, right, so ambiguity will be removed. I'll practically show you how, right? So advantages, again, fuzzy logic systems are built on top of the experience of experts. I've already given you that expert structures are actually taken into consideration, and their knowledge is always taken into consideration, right? So in this case, what we are talking about is we're talking about fuzzy logic being blended with the conventional controls techniques and the modern techniques, right? So what it does is it reduces the design development cycle, simplifies the design complexity, and we will be the first one to the market. So it reduces the time how we reach to the market, right? So this is a model structure. Today I have planned for implementation of a greenhouse structure using the fuzzy logic, right? So how will we do it and how will we design it? I'll just practically design it in front of you and then show you how easy it will be to design any of these complex systems using the fuzzy logic structure, right? So what we have is we have some input data over here. We have to fuzzify them. I've already told you there can be some functions to be selected. It can be it can be a Gaussian function, right? A Gaussian input. It can be a Z type input. It can be a triangular input. It can be a trapezoidal input. So whatever it is, right? So the fuzzification is done. Rules are formed if then. If this is this and this is this, then this is the output, right? So we'll be just talking in terms of it. So this is called as linguistic control strategy. Then we'll give it for defuzzification and you'll get the output, right? Similarly, the output can also be given to different actuators, which will be supplied as a feedback to this greenhouse controller and given back inside, right? So we'll see how this interesting thing happens, right? So I'll be talking about a greenhouse structure for the benefit of those who don't know how greenhouse or what a greenhouse structure would be. This is basically an artificially controlled structure where we design a structure or raise a structure to grow plants, right? So plants get good growth in this greenhouse part, right? So what we have is what we have to control for a good growth of plant. I hope everybody can talk about this. Light intensity, a good light source has to be there. The monitored temperature for the growth of enzymes, normal humidity or controlled humidity inside the structure, amount of carbon dioxide required for the plant, the air movement, the water and nutrients. All these are highly complex things, right? So how this greenhouse is right now working, this is working on on-off controllers. Basically, on-off controllers are used. Now, what we want is we want to replace them with automatic controllers, right? We want to replace them because on-off controllers are basically controlled by us. We have to go switch them on according to the input received or according to what we have done. Now, what we want is we want an automatic structure to be raised based on the fuzzy inputs, right? So we'll see how this happens, right? So the background is that we have an on-off system, traditional system, which is being implemented in greenhouse structures. So if you actually monitor a greenhouse, this greenhouse is highly non-linear, right? So why it is non-linear? Because the controlling of the variables are very, very, the temperature changes drastically, humidity changes accordingly, right? The airflow can change drastically within few minutes. It can be anything, right? So it is very, very highly non-linear, highly complex, and highly non-predictable, right? So we cannot say that for this much amount of time this would happen. Temperature can change at any point of time, right? So fuzzy logic controllers are a very, very advantageous solution for these kind of structures, right? So how will they work and how will we do it? The design objectives are, we want to design for this greenhouse climate change, right? To design a controller, what we need is, we need more efficient controllers and which consume less power and energy, right? And the dynamic controller has to be designed, right? So the dynamic in nature means that it adapts to the changing environment, right? So how fuzzy logic would come into picture and how fuzzy things would happen, right? I'm quickly going through these slides because I want to show you practically how this system works, right? So I've already given you what fuzzy systems are and how we are talking about. So fuzzy logic is what? Basically, it's superset of conventional Boolean logic, right? So kindly remember this term. We will be talking about Boolean logic only, ones and zeros, but it is superset of those, right? So where we involve intermediate values also, concept of partial truth, completely true, completely false, right? Say a value is one, another value is two and three. So we would recognize this as 1, 0, 1, whatever you want to, right? But if the value is 1.3 or 2.2 or 3.7, how would we recognize? We have to convert them to a near decimal, but fuzzy logic would actually take them as it is, right? So this is the best part. So we'll see how this happens and how the knowledge structure is taken into consideration, how linguistic variables are actually converted. So say temperature, this is a linguistic variable. Temperature, it might be freezing, it might be cold, it might be warm, it might be hot. Speed can be slow, normal and fast, right? So these are normal linguistic structures, and now they will be implemented, they will be utilized to implement it in the using the fuzzy logic structure, right? So here's an example. I'll just tell you now for the temperature, how cool is 36 degree Fahrenheit? So you have a chart where we have freezing, cold, warm and hot. Temperature ranges from 10 to 110, but basically hot means we're talking about some other source here. We're not talking about a room temperature in this case, right? And we have this membership values from 0 to 1, right? So freezing means the value has been given from 0 to this, right? So there are so many values you see. They are represented by a Z type. A triangular type represents a cold structure. Another triangle represents a warm structure, right? So here you can see a question is now what is, how cool is 36 degree Fahrenheit? So this is in Fahrenheit, so we are talking about Fahrenheit structures here. So there can be many answers. One of the answers can be it is 30% cool and 70% freezing according to the data given to us, right? So how will we take this into consideration? How your system would behave? Now this is what I wanted to show you. There are so many things that can be done. And in the meantime, I'll show you this chart once I start designing, right? So this is what we want, right? So this will be the system control. So I hope you are all familiar with this kind of environment here, right? I hope everybody is able to hear my voice. There is no problem in the voice because I was unable to see the screen.
Yes, sir. It is clearly audible, sir.
Great.
No issues at all.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So I would now require the participants to talk to me because I'm taking over from this point to practically designing the system, right? I've tried to explain what we will do. And now what we'll do is we'll try and design our own system, right? So I would request you to kindly see and help me design the system with all of you. So in the last lecture, I had talked about starting this lab view. I had given you how to start. So new VI has to be taken into consideration, right? So Control T shortcut would help us see both these windows. Now, what we want to do is we want to design a greenhouse structure. I'll just show you the flow chart and then I can move ahead, right? We want to design this greenhouse model in LabVIEW. This is the part that we want to do. Now, this is practical application, right? So what we need to do is we need to design a fuzzy control system for greenhouse environment. To remove those previous controllers, that on-off controllers have to be replaced, right? So we are talking about a fuzzy controller over here. So what we need to do is we need to implement a fuzzy controller in this case. Simulation of the design has to be done and optimization of the system needs to be done. So optimization can be done with the help of a feedback structure that we showed that the value, the crisp output is given back to the system, right? So we'll see how this is done. Now this is how the system would look like, right? So I'll show you practically how to use this and how this system would help you recognize what we are trying to do. So we move back to LabVIEW part again. I hope everybody is able to see my screen and you can even switch on your mics and talk to me directly. Again, I repeat, the whatever interaction you have here would be beneficial to everybody, right? So what we need to do is we need to go to tools. I'm taking it very slow over here, tools. Go to control design and simulation over here and click onto fuzzy system design, right? Again, I repeat, for those who are not able to see it, tools, control design and simulation, and go to fuzzy system designer. Just click onto this fuzzy system designer and a window would open in front of you, right? Because my system is a bit slower right now. So it's taking some time to load. Right, so here is the window in front of you now. Fuzzy system designer is what we have to use. Variables, rules, and test system. These are three windows that you can see over here. Now, how to use it effectively, I'm just trying to show you. Just see it and stop me wherever you don't follow the things, right? So what we have here in this window is we have input variables and we have output variables. Two things, you can see them. I'm just moving my cursor over here, right? So you can see that. Input variables and we have output variables, right? So these are the two things that you normally see. So for the greenhouse part, what we require is we require some kind of inputs over here. So what we'll do is we'll just make a chart for us that what type of inputs we require, right? And what should be the outputs in this case. So I'll just show you the input part over here. So what we can do is we can have inputs as solar radiation, the temperature and the humidity. So we have to make this kind of a model for us where what we decide is that what you need to do is solar radiation. Say for example, solar radiation. Solar radiation in lux, this is the measurement unit over here. It can be dark, moderate, maybe medium, or it may be light, right? So these are three conditions over here. Temperature can be cold, normal and warm. So we're talking in linguistic fashion only, right? So humidity also can be different forms. It can be dry, it can be normal, and it can be wet. So these are three different conditions that we need to follow. And once we follow them, we'll be able to design our own system, right? So I'll just move over input variables. Now how this window came over, click onto plus, this plus, click onto this. Name is temperature. Need to give the range, say from 0 to say 100 only. I give it as 100, right? 0 to 100 is the temperature range that I take. And I press OK. So you will see an input variable temperature. Similarly, you can add humidity over here. Again, I can take range from 0 to 100 and I press OK. So you'll see temperature, humidity, and the third part is solar radiation, right? So this is the input that we have. Solar radiation, again, I take the same value, 0 to 100 range, right? Again, press OK. So what you see is input variables, temperature, humidity, and solar radiation. Similarly, the outputs that need to be controlled, as shown in this particular part, two outputs, water sprinkler and electric roof. These are the two outputs, right? So again, I'll use the same output variables. So what I use is water sprinkler. See, I'm taking some random data over here. I'm not taking some values so that which are actually justified, but this is just a normal talk that we are having, and I'm taking some normal values according to my experience, right? So water sprinkler is the first output, and the second output is the electric roof. So I type them, and I'm just taking a range from 0 to 100 for all of them, right? So water sprinkler, electric roof, these are two output variables that will be controlled by the fuzzy system designer that we are trying to build, right? With the inputs temperature, humidity, and solar radiation. So these are three inputs that we have taken. Now comes our expert system into consideration. How will we talk about this? So what we see here is we have a membership function and we have a range. Now double click onto this temperature again, you'll see that window coming in front of you, right? So what you need to do is you'll see the membership function graph from 0 to 100. This is the minimum and maximum. And now what you need to do is you need to press this add button. So temperature, according to our map, if you see, we have cold, normal, and warm. These are three conditions that you have. So warm is the first condition that I take, and I take a shape of trapezoidal, and I change this color also so that it looks good for me. Warm, right? So a temperature range from 100 to 80 to 70 and to a 50 would work for me, right? So this is just a random data that I'm taking. Again, very interesting random data that I've taken. We would term this as warm temperature for us, right? Then I add another input to this. The second part should be normal, right? So normal temperature I want, normal, right? Normal, I take triangular value only, right? And I change again the color. So what should be normal over here? Normal can be from 60, 30, or say 40 and 20 for me. Just trying to gauge out what should be a normal temperature in normal terms only, right? The third part should be cold. So plus one, add again, and you write cold over here, cold. So now I'm writing cold. Again, I take a triangular function only. I change the color to blue, and I start with 30, 20, and a 0 for me. I can take 30 over here, right? Now you see, and press OK. Now you see the things: temperature, warm, normal, and cold. Can you see this over here? Anyone who can switch on their mic so that I am able to understand that you are actually following the things. Are you able to recognize this?
Yes.
Temperature.
Yes.
In normal terms. Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you. Temperature in normal terms again: warm, normal, and cold, right? Humidity, as far as we were concerned, is in different forms: dry, normal, and wet, right? So these are three different aspects of humidity: dry, normal, and wet. So what I take is wet first, wet. I can take a Gaussian function for this. Whatever you want to select, right? This is just a normal, this is just a random data that I want, right? Range should be 200. So I've taken it from 100. So 100, 90, 80, and similarly, 60 would be fine for me. So this is the Gaussian function. Now you see over here, humidity wet. I add another value, normal to this, normal. I take trapezoidal function. I take a trapezoidal function for me, right? And then again, 80, 60, 40, and 30 would work for me, right? Then dry. I can take a triangular function in this case, right? Dry means I start with say 45 for me. I take an intermediate value, 20, 45, right? So these are three values for humidity randomly taken by me. Right now we have temperature and humidity. The next part that we have is solar radiation. Solar radiation according to our map is dark, medium and light, right? So again, we can have this dark, medium and light. So light means maximum solar radiation coming. Again, you can take any of the functions. Say I take triangular only, right? So I change this color over here. 100 and 80 and 60 for me would work, right? So light, a lot of light coming inside it. Right, light, then medium, and then dark. Right, so medium, I can take a trapezoidal function for this medium part, and I change this color so that I'm able to recognize them. So medium means 80, 60 value for me, 40 for me, and can be a 20 for me, right? So I'm just taking some random values, and then dark. Dark means when there is no sunlight coming over, and I can keep a triangular function in that case, right? So I can start with 45 over here, right? 20 over here, and a 0 would work. So I can take this value to 40 also, no problems, right? Now you can see what happens, right? So you can see all these three values over here with different functions. I have taken all the different functions according to the input values that I had. This is just, again, I repeat, a random data that I'm selecting, right? So you have to do this. Anyone who has not followed this or anyone who wants to ask any question up till here is most welcome.
Any questions?
Okay, nobody. I think nobody is willing enough. So water sprinkler and electric roof are the two outputs in this case, right? So now water sprinkler and electric roof. So water sprinkler can be basically moderate. It can be more or it can be less, very less also, right? So these are some inputs that we have from our journal information, right? So I can take more first. I take a triangular function in this case, 100. 90 and 70, right? More, moderate. Again, you can select any of the functions according to the data that is available, but right now I'm just doing it randomly, right?
So there is a question asked Dasri Ananta sir. He is asking that how it is useful in medical image analysis.
Okay, ma'am, I'll go to that also, but right now what I can do is I can keep that to a hold, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. I'll keep that in my mind and I'll tell you about that also. Moderate?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Less. Take this. Okay, let's keep it black only over here. Less means 60, 40, and 20 over here, right?
DSP coordinator.
60, 40 and 20 is less. Very less. Can be from say 25 for me, 10 for me, a 0 for me, right? So I have taken these values. Now you see, all those will be represented over here. Electric roof, again, electric roof can be open, closed, or semi-closed, right? So these are three inputs. Open, triangular function. Open means I want, or say, it is 100, 80 and 60 for me, right? Open, semi-closed, we have semi-closed over here, semi-closed, I can take values from 80, 40, 60 and 40 would work, right? And then I can add another value, closed. Right, so these are again, as you see, all used as random values. They might not be even to the extent correct that we want, but still, I'm just trying to use some random values for me. So now you see, this is the homework that we need to do. That is what I was trying to say. The homework, it comes from what? It comes from whom? It is coming from the experts. It is coming from the literature. It is coming from the background, right? So temperature, humidity and solar radiation, three inputs and two output variables, right? Water sprinkler and electric roof. This is what we have. Now what we need to do is, the input part that we had to give to the system is over for us. This is the only information that we wanted to give, right? Now the next part comes into picture is the rules. Now this is here. I told you, if then, you see, if then, you can see this, right? So if you press add a rule, it will say if temperature is warm, then water sprinkler is more. A good rule has come into picture. But what about the other parts? The other antecedents are still missing. So what you need to do is you need to go at this point, press add, because how many antecedents we had, you need to see that. Humidity and then solar radiation. Now you see the rule is getting added automatically over here. You can see this. If temperature is warm and humidity is wet and solar radiation is light, then water sprinkler is more. One of the rules, right? There can be another consequence to this. Electric roof. So now this add another rule, add the antecedents, add the consequence over here. The rule gets added again. You can change these rules according to what you want, right? Whatever you want to do, whatever randomly you want to see, you can see those things also over here. You can keep on adding these rules. There is no limit to that, right? There is no limit, entirely no limit to all the rules. Now what I need to do is, but I want some intelligence to come into picture, right? So what I want is, I don't want to set rules on my own. I want my system should actually gauge from the input data that I've received, and it should become artificially intelligent to tell me which rules suit the best for this system, or which are the best rules for this kind of a structure, right? So what I need to do is, I need to clear all the rules here. First I'll clear all the rules. Now you need to do what? You need to go to operate, go to pre-generate all the rules. Now click onto this pre-generate rules. It will show you 27 rules will be generated for three input variables that we have selected. All previously created rules will be deleted. We've already done that, right? So there is no problem. What type of consequent you want to use, and that is minimum, product, maximum, probabilistic. All the functions are available. You can see this. Degree of support, keep it one. Consequent implication, there are two implications available, minimum and product. This is based on the entire model that I showed you in the beginning, right? So you can see this, right? You can select either of these. Just press OK. You'll see all the rules which are best possibly suited for this kind of a system that we have given the input are here. You can see this now. Temperature is warm, humidity is wet, solar radiation is light, and water sprinkler is more, and electric roof is open. This is one of the rules, right? Now, there are 27 rules. They have been created over here. You can see them. Defuzzification was the last step that we had to do. Defuzzification method means five methods that I gave you. Center of area, modified center of area, center of sums, center of maximum, center of minimum, right? Or mean of maximum. So, you can select either of these. Consequent antecedent is and. Degree of support is one. Consequent implication is minimum. You can even change it after this, but right now the rules have been based on whatever inputs you have given according to the structure that we had, right? So now what we want is, we want the next part to go. Variables have been decided. Rules have been made out of this. The third part, defuzzification method, has also been selected. Now comes the output, the crisp value. You go to the test system and you see input variables over here. You see output variables over here. You see plot variables over here. And this is the invoked rules. Now how this would work? Just have a look. It will be very easy for us. Temperature and humidity. These are two things. Output variables can be water sprinkler and electric roof. You need to select that. Say the temperature is this, humidity is this, right? So what should be, or say solar radiation is now, I'm just increasing the value, right? Solar radiation is this. What is the output? This is the output. How many rules have struck? You can see this. How many rules have struck? Right now you see the test system output behaving. You can see this change happening. You can see the entire change happening. I can change the solar radiation also.
Sir, we are not able to see that.
You're not able to see that?
Yes, sir. The output part of that.
No, this is the output.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is the output. Now, the output, I'm rotating it for you.
Right.
You can see the rules which are being fired are over here. Right. The output part is this according to whatever data I had given. Right.
Yes, sir.
You can rotate it accordingly. You can see the values. You can even plot it to different charts. Right. For humidity, even temperature to temperature can also be taken in this case. Right. I'm just trying to show you. What rules are there and what weight? So see the weight. My cursor is here. Right? So these rules have fired according to the input values. And accordingly, the water sprinkler, also the electric roof part. Right? So you can see the output. I hope everybody can see this now. So this is how easy it was to design one of the most complex problems of a greenhouse structure. Now you can just rotate it accordingly, whatever you wish to do. You can see the values, right? I hope you were able to analyze this.
Yes,
you can do it again. You can do it again. You can clear all the rules again. Go to operate, pre-generate all the rules, right? You can change this to different parameters. Selected this. I can change this modified center of sums. Right, and I can just change it, right? Solar radiation, the humidity. Now you see, again, according to what we have planned, new rules and new weights would come. New outputs would be depicted. Right, so this is how easy it was to implement this kind of a complex scenario. Right now, we have just taken three inputs and two output variables. You can increase the input. You can change the variables. You can add more variables to this. According to the data, whatever you have, you can change whatever inputs you want. Right. So this is the complete fuzzy system designer in front of you, where you designed the complex greenhouse controller for your own benefit. Now, how will we use it? I've already modeled this system, but I'm just waiting for if there are any questions to be asked, right? Is there any questions still here? So I'll, after this, I'll show you the modeling. I've already modeled a fuzzy system designer, right? So we have made a fuzzy system designer for our own problem, and now we'll be using it, right? Anybody who wants to ask something in this case? Any questions still here? I hope my voice is pretty much audible.
Yes, sir, it is audible, and I don't think they have any questions. I think we also need some time to practice it also. So it is very clear.
Definitely. So that is why I just took that lecture in the earlier half, so that you, the participants would have been well versed with the NI software right now. But still, again, this is one of the easiest things that you can actually achieve as far as the modeling of a complex non-linear system is concerned, right? So nevertheless, no problems. I had to show this to you so that you actually believe what I'm trying to talk about. So we have finally designed this. Now what I'm doing is I'm just going to one of the examples over here, right? And similarly, I'll just open the controller design so that you are able to acknowledge that we will be able to actually model this, right? Oh, accidentally, I think I just switched off my screen. Are you able to see my screen, ma'am?
No, sir.
Is it available now?
Yeah, it is. Yes, sir.
Great. So I'll just open the system for you. And we have a fuzzy greenhouse controller, inbuilt controller for us, right? Now, this is how it looks like. This is the fuzzy controller that we have made. And this is the entire things. Now, at the back end, what we have done is we have just provided controls like I did in last lecture. The slider for temperature, slider for humidity, and these are the outputs, the electric roof and water spills. Now, this is an automatic dynamic controller for fuzzy logic structure. Now, you'll see how this would behave, right? Now, this is basically being controlled by us only, and I'll show you one of the controllers that we have designed where input is being received real time and the system behaves accordingly, right? Now, see, I'll just run this. And you'll say I change this season to summer. Now you'll see some changes happening in the electric roof and water spill.
Yes.
I hope you're able to see this.
Yes, sir.
I'm just changing the temperature and the system is behaving accordingly. Similarly, I'm changing the humidity part and the system is behaving accordingly. Say now I change my season from summer to spring. Again, you see the change happening.
Yes.
I change from spring to fall and then to winter. You can see the change happening, right? I hope everybody can see this.
Yes, sir, it is visible.
So this is how dynamically temperature or humidity would change inside this greenhouse. And this is how the electric roof and water spills would be controlled according to the input received from the temperature and humidity. Right. Now, very interestingly, what we need to do is we need to understand how this can be done real time. So I'll show you another example where I'll do it real time for you. Right. Right. Now, this is the same model. If you can see, I've added solar radiation. The solar radiation was missing in that. Now, this is real time. There is no slider over here. You can see that there is no slider. The only slider is for the solar radiation part, right? Because we cannot actually, we don't have any instrument to measure solar radiation, costly instrument for us, right? So now you can see this is a real time input happening. So it is being also changed accordingly. As soon as the inputs change, similarly you see the output values changing, the electric roof and water sprinkler. Now this is real time happening, and this is the recording of the output graphs. You can see over here, right? The temperature, humidity, the electric roof, water sprinkler, etc., etc., are being plotted. You can see them very well. Any movements would be recorded. Similarly, easily I can just right click onto this. In last lecture, somebody asked me how to export the data. So we have a right click onto this particular graph, right click, export, whatever you want. Export to clipboard, export to Excel, export to image, whatever you want. Export to Excel. I just click onto Excel. You'll see an Excel file opening in front of me. Right now, this is the data. So this is that simple. I can keep a record of all the data files, right? Export to Excel file, simply. So the entire length which has been monitored will be just exported to you, right? So this is a simple thing, or this is how simply we can actually use them. Now this is real-time monitoring of the system being done. The temperature and humidity being monitored by different sensors being given to the fuzzy logic controller. According to the season, the output values are controlled, right? So these were two systems that I wanted to show. And I still hope that you are able, I can just increase the length also so that you are able to see clearly. Right? I just increased it. Right, so you can see that. You can see the changes happening. Fine, so that's the system that I wanted to show to you. And this is one of the systems that we have been able to design effectively for the fuzzy logic part. Any questions still here? So if there are no questions, I'll just continue with my presentation and I'll try and end this. So this is what I showed you, the front panel view of the design structure that we had, right? So this is the front panel view, and again, according to the inputs, how many rules were possible has been depicted. The table has to be designed by you, the input variables and the input functions. The defuzzification method, again, I showed you, right? From five of the methods, you can select either, right? So you can select either of these methods, the defuzzification would work. And similarly, how to design this fuzzy system designer, we have already done this. Now you can see temperature, humidity, solar radiation, electric roof, water sprinkler, some of the data inside this, right? You can see them. The rules, we have just formulated these rules, if then, right? And this is the defuzzification method, right? Then the test system, you can see this test system. It would behave accordingly, right? All the rules that are fired over here and the weights. So this is the output. Now output can be taken directly from these also. You can see them, right? So this is it, the backend part, and now the input variables. I'll just quickly show you the results over here, the results that I was trying to show you. Here they are, right? Average power consumed by an on-off controller is about 82%. Average power consumed by a water sprinkler using fuzzy controller is 40%. Now this is again based on the season part, right? Average power consumed by electric roof using fuzzy controller is around 13%. So we see the reduction that we were able to do. How much power we were able to save, right? I hope you are able to hear me.
Yes, sir.
Yes, right. So comparison of the water sprinkler and electric roof in the terms of power, now you can see how much power we have saved, 13%. Now this is the range that we are getting for the different seasons over here. Have a look. Just imagine 82% power being consumed by a on-off controller and almost half of the power being consumed. So we have saved a lot of energy, right? So this is how you can actually easily do it. And this is dynamically monitored also. Some of the future works can also involve the PID controller being implemented, the ZigBee module being implemented. So these are some of the new technologies, right? We are normally using this Wi-Fi. Now the model or the diagram that I skipped, I will just try and show you that. Quickly go to that. This is the model, right? Now you see, we are working on this. What we want is we want a monitoring base station, a weather monitoring base station to be connected with different nodes. You can see these clusters over here. They are gathering the information. Different sensors are involved. The information is gathered at a particular point over here. This gathered information is then transmitted to the greenhouse directly, right? And the greenhouse behaves immediately according to that monitored output, right? So this is the real-time monitoring that we want to do and spread this information to different other nodes also. Say a storm is coming. The information can be gathered here and then be transmitted to the next area. So he can be well prepared for that, right? So these are the things, these are small things that we can do where we can involve WSN or wireless sensor network in the different measurement systems, right? So that's it from my side. I don't know whether I was too fast or too slow in analyzing and explaining the facts to you, but there are so many things that you can do with it. Now to the question that somebody asked, I don't know who asked that, but ma'am, can you just repeat that again for me?
Yes, sir. The question is how it is useful in medical image analysis.
Medical image analysis, I just showed you an example last time if you were there. I don't know.
Yeah, sir was there. He attended the sessions.
I thought that that example was self-explanatory in that case. Nevertheless, I'll just show you again. I need to search that out over here. So, there are so many examples right now, but I don't know whether I'll be able to search it effectively. 3D image reconstruction would be that. I think so. Nevertheless, sir, yes, the answer to the question is that yes, definitely you can do it. Yes, this is the example. Now you can see this. This is a 3D image reconstructor, and we have a 2D image, that is medical images 2D, right? You all know that. It can be an ECG scan, it can be an X-ray scan, it can be an EEG scan, whatever you want to do, right? When I run this, this is the 2D image. And now out of this, a 3D image has been created. Again, I showed you in last lecture also, a 3D image has been created. The ISO value, if it can be changed, right, this is the major part. Now you see a face coming up, right? Everybody can see this, and we can actually recognize this face also somewhat, because you can see it from different angles. You can recognize the curves, the cuts, right, effectively, and then you can match them, go inside the skull also, right? So this is what can be easily done with the help of these kind of graphical softwares. Again, I repeat, I haven't written a single line code in any of the things that I've done. The best part is this. No language, no coding, only graphical language required, right? So you can see this, you can design it on your own, right? And if you want to see the skull from inside, what is the teeth, how do they look like, what is the eye hole type structure, right? So you can just change the ISO value and you'll get it. You'll get the image being reconstructed, right? So you can see it. So I am pretty much sure that this technology will help analyze many things, right? Biomedical image signal processing is one of the best fields right now, which with what we can work with and how effectively we can use them, right? So yes, we can do this. We can definitely do it, sir. I don't know whether I was able to answer you effectively or not, but this is true, sir.
Yes, sir. He has replied it as thank you, sir. And I really think that you are successful in creating interest in this lab view, sir. It's such a easy software, and I didn't knew about this personally, right, speaking. Right. Yes, it's so easy and it's very interesting.
Great. Yes. So any questions? Yeah. Anybody who wants to ask some questions?
any questions. You can share your experience also.
That would be great.
You can directly talk also otherwise.
Chaniya ma'am, I think we can just call this off now. If there are no questions, nobody is willing enough to speak. Nevertheless, I tried to introduce the things to you effectively, and if you can use them for your research part, then that would be great. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And they are replying it. They are saying it as a very good practical session. Really very nice session. They are speaking it out now.
Oh, that's great, but
they
I am unable to see chat. Yeah.
Achha, they are messaging it, sir. Okay.
Great.
Sir, they are asking for you. They are asking for your email ID.
Definitely. So what I'll do is I'll just write it in the chat only. I'm just seeing the chat now. I've just written it. Praveen ji, you're doing medical image processing. So a large toolbox is available for medical image processing in LabVIEW. Yes. So I have read your question. Yeah, I've already shared my mail ID. I hope you can get it now. That's great. I am able to read now. I was just not knowing the chat is also active here. So great. So thank you very much. Thanks to all the participants for listening to me very carefully, and hopefully that I would help you out in any of the problems that you have. Hopefully you'll be able to solve them on your own only, so you won't need my help in any case, but still, if you have, I'm most welcome. Thank you very much. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for having me over. Pleasure.
Thank you, sir. Here. So easily you explained the implementation of greenhouse. It was really a very interesting session.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you, Nikhil, sir. Thanks a lot. Thanks for utilizing our request and sparing your valuable time and thoughts. Thanks a lot.
It was a pleasure being with you among your research scholars and all the faculty from entire country. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Dear participants, I would like to invite you all to the valedictory session that will start 2 p.m. sharp. It will span for 10 to 15 minutes. Immediately after that, I will be sharing the link of quiz on your registered email ID. Looking forward to you in the valedictory session. Manjula ma'am, over to you.
Yes, ma'am. I think we can have a break for 45 minutes and then we'll join again. So till then, stay tuned. Be connected with us. We'll join at 2 sharp.
Thank you.
Vaibhav sir, you can stop recording.